my boss.
The first order of business is to review the minutes of the previous meeting, May 21, 1991. Hopefully everybody has a copy. Board members, any comments, corrections, questions?
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
On page 11 of the minutes, if we look under the heading Trustee of Sleepwear Estate Property, second paragraph down in that section, begins, Ms. O'Meara said a public access waiver is when, comma, and it goes on, the sentence almost seems to be missing something. I wondered if the planner could address that.
Page 11?
Yes.
Sorry, and which? Okay, I'll ask our planner if she remembers what the topic was.
Unfortunately, that was almost verbatim what I said.
Pardon?
That was almost verbatim what I said.
Oh.
I knew that. It was just seeing if everybody else remembered that.
Okay.
Then you can scratch the three words, though. I thought perhaps we would do that.
Is when it?
No, you just take is when and it out, yes, and say the waiver does not imply.
Okay. See what you mean by that. Okay. Any other questions? Comments? I just have one question again. It's of our planner. On page 9, last paragraph, Mr. Emery asked if there would be any other permits required. Ms. O'Meara felt no other permits would be required. However, the board may have asked for more information. Do you remember, just a point of clarification?
It was regarding the board's discussion of whether you could add conditions of approval to a permit that was basically allowing activity outside a wetland area. And the comment I was trying to make is that the conditions actually related to what ordinarily would be information that would have been supplied by an applicant anyway, so that you could argue that the conditions were really there in order to allow the applicant to get their approval that night rather than sending them away and asking them to add information to the plan.
Okay. So once again, that's exactly what you did say.
Do you have your microphones on? Because I seem to be having problems listening.
I don't think our technicians have the speakers on. Everybody has their microphones on? We'll try to speak up. Any more questions, comments?
I have the speakers on because it is very difficult to hear.
I'll have... should I have to speak that close? I'll try to keep the mic closer.
Yeah.
Oh. Well, I'll move back then. Everybody else speak up. Do I hear a motion on the minutes?
That they be approved as corrected?
Do I hear a second?
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there any other discussion? Not. All those in favor approving the minutes as moved, raise your right hand. Opposed? It's a unanimous vote. Next order of business are the notes of the planning board workshop, which we generally ask for a consensus of agreement. Any questions, comments, corrections? Seeing none, do I take that we accept them as written? Sorry, we won't need a motion, but we'll accept them. The next order of business is a fairly short list of correspondence received during the past month. The first item of correspondence merely is a note to the town council from our planner, explaining explaining the affordable housing ordinance amendments, explaining especially two different portions or facets of the ordinance. I understand that was taken to the town council and well received. I thank Janet McKay for representing the planning board, and I understand we were complimented on our work. I'm sure we'll see it back one or two or three or four times in the process. Next piece of correspondence, a very nice description of the site visit of the conservation lands of the South Cape region. I'm very sorry I personally missed that, but it sounds like it was a really good tour of the conservation lands.
Yes, I'd like to say that I'm sorry I missed that too, and that I hope it can be rescheduled at some later date so more people can enjoy the visit.
Actually, the description is almost good enough if you can pick up where those are on a map to visit some of those ourselves. A couple of new pieces of correspondence on my podium tonight. The first being a letter from the Law Office of Middle Assen, Eager and Hunter to our planner, dealing with a public access waiver for the sleeper lot. It refers to, in the body of the letter, the spur or the narrow piece of land that's shown on the maps submitted to date. I have not had a chance to read it, nor do I expect the other planning board members have. Should take a look at it in the future. Last piece is a letter from our town council, Thomas Leahy, Esquire, to Wayne Creelman, the chairman of the town council, dealing with conflicts of interest as it pertains to the planning board and land trust situation. I believe we had received a letter requesting a director be appointed from the planning board onto the land trust, and I have not read the letter, so I don't know what the attorney's opinion is as far as conflict of interest. We'll let you know next month. Perhaps, Maureen, did you have a chance to read through this letter before?
I believe that letter has been sent to the town council, and they will be making a final action on it.
Okay.
So we will be hearing further on it.
I would ask, as I did last month, if there are other issues to be placed on the new business agenda this evening. Seeing none, we'll take up the first order of old business. First order of old business is the Highlands at Broad Cove, a request by Peter D. Kennedy, Greater Portland Development Group, for amendment to the final subdivision approval of a 20-lot subdivision located in the vicinity of Channel View Road, Kent's Point Road Extension, Winding Way and Two Lights Road, Section 16-2-4, C7. I'd ask that the applicant come to the podium and identify yourself.
Excuse me, Mr. Chairman, I have to step down on this issue due to bias.
Okay. This I'll appoint Judy Lardner as a voting member.
Good evening. I'm Peter Kennedy, Greater Portland Development Group.
Do you wish to just take three or four minutes and go over your request this evening?
Okay. As in the last month, I've been having a great difficulty in negotiating a letter of credit documentation through People's Heritage Bank, mainly because of a cease and desist order that they've been placed under by the federal government. So consequently, all applications for loans through the bank must now go to their full board of directors and other layers of in the approval process. So I sense that I'm going to be delayed significantly in this request for a letter of credit. Therefore, my current intentions are to try to raise the amount requested, the $281,000, in cash and give it to the town, but that also will take some time. I have also explored the possibility today with the planner of breaking up the Phase 1 into a Phase 1A and Phase 1, building a road off of Two Lights Road just to start in the project and posting a cash bond for that. But I don't have the amounts yet. I could have those in about a week or so for the board and town manager's approval, along with the town engineer. That might be a solution of getting the project started in a obviously a tough real estate market and enable the start of the road and water line and power line and emergency access road heading into the Broad Cove area.
Maureen, any other issues to summarize before this discussion?
Well, included in the memorandum to the board is a memorandum from the town manager where he has made some requests regarding extension of the letter of credit, recording of the plat, and also and also an ability to re-review the amount when the letter of credit is finally drafted and submitted to the town. What you have before you is a draft motion which would include some conditions on the approval and amend that original condition. The way you have it stated now, the applicant is required to submit a letter of credit within 30 days of the approval, which means that letter of credit would have to be submitted by the end of this week. Otherwise, the subdivision approval becomes invalid.
Thank you. Any discussion, questions, comments?
One question. Is there any deadline on the DEP approval if there's no start of construction? Does it lapse?
I believe the DEP approval is good for 5 years.
Okay. Thank
That's
you.
Correct.
Other questions? Seems to be a fairly straightforward request of the applicant.
May I ask just a...
Certainly.
It's sort of aside from this, but just out of curiosity. You know, you were thinking of starting to build the Farm Pond Road, right?
The Jordan Farm Road.
Jordan Farm Road.
This road here, about 500 feet into here.
Okay, and you would start doing water and utilities?
From Two Lights Road.
From Two Lights Road.
That's where they exist now.
Okay, that wouldn't be able to... At that point, though, to complete the water loop.
No, the water loop has to go all the way
through
the winding way to complete the loop.
Okay.
It would start it.
Okay, that's just as a concern. I think this is, you know, it's life in real estate in 1991. 30 days to get a letter of credit is just almost impossible. So I think it's.
Questions?
Steve, I was reading the comments while Maureen was speaking, and I think I missed the point she was making. It follows up on the DEP issue. When, if any, expiration date is there on the current approval, subdivision approval?
Well, in going over the ordinance, there's 90 days that you have to record a subdivision plat once three or four steps are met. So the way the ordinance is currently drafted, the clock doesn't start ticking just because the board has made the approval. The plat has to be submitted with a letter of credit and has to be signed, and then the 90-day clock starts ticking.
Okay. Is there any state statute that supersedes a town municipal ordinance in reference to the 90-day?
Not that I'm aware of.
Not that I'm aware of.
That's all.
Okay.
Any other questions? If not, do I hear a motion?
I will. Be it ordered that based on worsening market and economic conditions and the facts presented, the request of Peter D. Kennedy of Greater Portland Development Group, Inc. for an amendment to Condition 1 of the final subdivision approval of the Highlands, a 20-lot subdivision located in the area of Channel View Road, Hunts Point Road Extension Winding Way, and Two Lights Road be granted in accordance with Section 16-2-4C of the subdivision ordinance so that the Condition 1 will now be, quote, 1. That an executed irrevocable letter of credit be submitted to the town of Cape Elizabeth in an amount and form acceptable to the town manager and town attorney prior to May 21st, 1992, prior to recording of the subdivision plat, and prior to the start of any construction within the subdivision, in accordance with section 16-2-4, paren C, paren 7, paren A.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there any further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor of the motion as read, please raise your right hand. Those opposed, it's unanimous vote, 5-0.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Next order of business on old business, public access waiver request by the trustee of the Sleeper State property for public access waiver of lot off of Ocean House Road. Public hearing, section 19-4-2B. Procedurally, I guess I'd like to ask that the applicant come to the podium, identify themselves, or a representative of the applicant. Just very briefly, bring us up to date with this application for just a few minutes. Then I'll open the public hearing, and then I'll have the chance for a short period for the applicant to respond to any questions, and then board discussion. Good evening.
Hi. My name is Richard Michael. I'm from Dufresne Henry Engineering, representing the Sleeper State. As a way of refreshing the board as where we were last time, I put back on the podium a plan that shows, taken from tax map actually, that shows the location of the lot, which we're asking for a waiver of public access. About a week ago, we took a site walk, and there was one question that was asked at that time, and that was that you asked me to respond to tonight, and that was the capability for putting a turnaround on within the lot. And you probably didn't get a chance to see that particular plan, but it was sent to the town engineer for their review, and I suppose other town offices. I've enlarged the scale on that and shown in yellow on this plan a modified hammerhead turnaround that I believe would be capable of turnaround for emergency vehicles. The reason for the layout was the intent, the yellow section coming in there is the entrance road. It's likely that the garage area would be in this particular location. So that's the reason for the location of that road, approximately the center of the lot. And going by your own standards for hammerhead turnarounds, dead-end streets, that roughly approximates that dimension. Just to kind of orient you as far as the size of this, this is approximately 60 feet from this location to the other side of that turnaround there, so it's a pretty fair distance. This scale now that is enlarged is about 1 inch equals 15 feet. So that was, I think that answers the question that you had. I can't speak for whether it's suitable or not, but I believe it is. I don't recall any other questions that were raised during the site walk, but I certainly am here to answer any that may have arisen or still are on your mind.
What I'd like to do first is open up the public hearing, and then we'll return, and perhaps you can respond. You might listen carefully to public comment, and hopefully respond to some of those questions as well.
Fine.
At this time, I open the public hearing. I urge members of the public to address the board. This is how we get public feedback and comments and concerns from the public. There was a fair amount of correspondence last month in reference to this issue. I would just, before we start, so I have some sense of timing, get some indication of how many people would intend to speak this evening. Okay. Very good. It doesn't mean you have to or you don't have to. It's okay, fine. I would urge everybody, it's not intimidating at all. I would ask that you keep your comments concise and reasonably brief. I'd ask that you direct your comments to the issue at hand with this article. I'll open it now to any member of the public. Yes, sir.
Mr. Chairman, before we start the public hearing process, I wonder if the town planner could just give us a slight introduction to what a public access waiver is for the record.
Okay. Excuse me, sir. We'll just have a brief explanation. It would be helpful to you folks as well.
If you want to get a building permit for a lot in the town of Cape Elizabeth, you have to have an adequate amount of frontage on an accepted town road. If you do not have frontage on an accepted town road, you cannot get a building permit unless you receive something called a public access waiver. The waiver does not give anyone the right to cross over a private right-of-way. It doesn't give the public the right to cross over the right-of-way. The intent of a public access waiver is to review the proposed access to a lot to make sure that there's appropriate access for emergency vehicles and that you're not going to be creating a dangerous situation by allowing someone to build on that lot. So it's a procedure the town has for allowing some lots that don't have frontage on an accepted town road to receive building permits.
Thank you. Now we'll open it up to public comment. Yes, sir. If you could approach the podium and identify yourself, please.
I'm Al Martin, and our family abuts the proposed public access. In this lot right here, which the access would go from here to the lot, our lot, our ownership is right here, and our house is right here. So arguably, we could perhaps be considered as most affected by your approval of the access. I think that, gratifyingly, I will be brief. I don't have a lot to say, but I hope you will consider what I have to say. And that is, you do have a lot of information in front of you that has been prepared by professional people, technical people, the town planner, the town engineer. You have lots of information concerning widths of the public access, how sightings were done, how easily it will be for vehicles of any nature, whether it's emergency or otherwise, to get to this proposed lot. And I think that you have had time to study them and will do a good job evaluating them. One thing that you may not have in front of you, I don't think you do, and that is perhaps the feelings of the people that will be most affected by your granting the access. And I do hope that you will consider in your decision how we as people, perhaps a half a dozen of us, how much we are committed to keeping this area a unique, undeveloped area in the long term. We've all been residents of Cape Elizabeth for a number of years, 20 or so, and as you took the walk, you did see that the public access, if it were granted, would in fact allow vehicles access by, in our case, our house, our backyard, our garage, around our circle. And it's a very unnatural situation, and it does impact us considerably. We're committed to wanting this area to be one of the last bastions, you might say, in Cape Elizabeth of undeveloped shorefront property. And I just hope that in your decision, along with all the technical and mechanical aspects that you'll be considering. You'll consider the desires of the people that it will most affect, and I can honestly say that we hope you don't approve it.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Martin. Any other members of the public wish to speak? Yes, ma'am.
I am Polly Morrison, and I'm at 414 Old Ocean House. And I am the house right here as the entrance touches Old Ocean House. I hope as you walked last week, you would stand at the driveway in Old Ocean House at the opening and evaluate the curve and the rise in the road and consider the this idyllic country setting has a lot of traffic on Old Ocean House, and I'm saying the traffic really does fly at times. So I hope as you evaluate this situation, you do consider not just emergency vehicles, but you consider service vehicles. You consider just normal traffic. As people enter the driveway, it is a dirt road. As vehicles leave the driveway onto a reasonably heavily traveled Old Ocean House. I know it's not as heavy as 77, but there is a lot of traffic. And I hope that in looking to the left and the right, as well as down that driveway, you certainly do take into account other traffic in the different directions.
Thank you very much. Any other members of the public? Yes, sir.
Good evening. I'm Dick Morrison, 414 Old Ocean House Road. The one area that my wife perhaps failed to mention that I think is something that you should indeed consider is that the dirt road that goes from Old Ocean House Road back to where the Martins, where Al was just talking about, is a straightaway. And I heard with interest that it doesn't have public access, and I would hope that you would perhaps rethink that. We have a lot of people who do not live in our neighborhood that go down that road. Whether they are just curiosity seekers, I don't know what they are, but they go down our road. Our house is approximately 11 feet from the corner of the from the point of our house to the beginning of the left side of the road as you're going down towards the Martins or towards the water. I have on many occasions, as you can well imagine, coming out with a lawnmower or whatever, you can be backing out, you can be walking backwards. It is something obviously that is a personal problem. But I am really concerned about the safety. We do not have little children, but I do have two children. That is a safety hazard that you would be granting if you pass this favorably. That, now I'm not saying all people, but there are several teenagers that go at a fairly rapid speed down that road. And if you were to add that to another family or another family with children, we're just adding to the possibilities that something unsafe could occur. It's true that Al Martin and his family are probably more affected than I am, but the speed, at least they have to slow down to go past his garage as you walk and his circle. They don't slow down as they go past my house and my driveway and where I'm walking. So I would hope that you would consider that in your decision this evening.
Thank you, Mr. Morrison. Any other members of the public which would like to speak? Yes, ma'am.
Good.
My name is Richardson, and I live at 440 Old Ocean House Road. And I'm not in a butter,
but I think I've been sort of left in the dark. I've heard all about this access road. I'd like to, I know David Sleeper, I'd like to know what plans he has for that place. I remember his saying very definitely that after he had sold the land to, I think he sold it to the Hamptons, did he originally, that he had not been left enough acreage to ever build on his little spot of land. And I would like to know what the plans are for this property, because from the front of our property, we get a very clear view of David's.
Thank you very much. Any other members of the public would you like to address us? Seeing none, I'll close the public hearing. And I guess initially I'd like to ask the applicant if they have any comments or response to the questions asked, and then I'll open it up to the board to ask questions and make comments.
I don't have a lot of specific comments. I thought the comments were well voiced, and there's no question that the road is not as wide as a standard width road, and probably never should be because of the character of the neighborhood. And because of that, it will never be as safe as a road that's built to town standards. I would ask that along with considering perhaps the safety, considering the rights of the owner of the lot, that it is a lot of record, should have the capability of being a buildable lot as long as there isn't an extreme safety hazard and other problems created because of the lot. I don't know what the particular plans are for the lot. As an individual, I've never even met the Sleepers, so I don't know what their plans are. I think the board, and I'm not saying anything new, has an obligation to sort of stand back and look at everything. The road is not built now according to standards. The site distance as the road enters Old Ocean House is adequate. More than adequate in both directions for the posted speed limit, and I guess that's about the only comments I have other than answering questions.
Okay, at this time I'd like to open it up to the board for questions. I think there are a number of issues, just as one board member, that can be addressed, some that I don't think, at least I don't have the information in front of me yet. But I'll open it up to the board members. Judith?
Okay, I have a number of things I wanted to say, not the least of which is my usual preface about how sitting up here you're caught between two places. Obviously, this parcel of land has a deeded right-of-way, and that everyone who lives in there always knows that everyone's had a right to use the right-of-way to get to it. I also... And then that part of me that says that they probably should be able to get to the property. There is another part of me that is very curious about the proposed development of what's going to happen. The nature of the property itself is very quaint. I was not on the sidewalk, but I have been in there as an invitee once. No sneaking in. I never go in private roads, ever. I'm terrified. Someone will yell at me. But it is a very quaint. The houses are quaint. There's a lot of space. There's a certain feeling, ambiance about it that would be it would just be a sacrilegious if the wrong kind of property was put in there. I could, you know, some of these big modern houses with all the goop-de-goops would just look dreadful. But then again, I'm not here to make an architectural decision. I've thought about the access problems. I wonder how many cars per day are really going to have that much of an impact. There are a number of cars using it, a number of homes that use the right-of-way. I frankly was more concerned with, or have been more concerned with the possibility of construction. I can't envision the big dump trucks and the blasters and the loaders tracking in and out. That's a real question for me. But then again, it's only a public access waiver, which is how do we deal with a house that doesn't have, or a property that doesn't have frontage on an accepted street. I'm really curious as to, first of all, how big would the building envelope be? Now, by the time you get your site setbacks and your shoreline zoning, there's not a lot of room in there. Could you speak to that?
I'm Robert Middle. I'm the attorney for the trustee. The deed from Mary Sleeper to the Hamptons that established this lot has in it about, well, almost a page of restrictions on what can be built. Let me just summarize it rather than read it. Only a dwelling house and garage. It's got to be of good workmanship and materials suitable on choice suburban land. The garage has got to be in conformity, architectural conformity, with the dwelling house. It can't be more than 2.5 stories high. And then there are square foot limitations depending on how big it is. So that to the extent that you can ever in a deed limit what can happen 20 years or 30 years or for that matter 150 years hence, it's been done here. And that's what the deed says. What ultimately gets done is up to the person who ultimately buys and builds a house on this land. Is that enough of an answer?
Yes.
I think the board has the deed.
I'm sure I do. I was more concerned right now with the size of the building envelope. If that...
Oh, okay.
I can see it, but I can't...
I think what she's asking is there's a trapezoid-shaped piece there with the setbacks, 100-foot setback in the side and in the rear. It's a little bit different. It looks like the southwest end would be about 15 feet in the northeast side, which is shoreline setback. Now I'm showing exactly what it is.
Yeah. The thought about whether you can put a reasonable building on that buildable portion of the lot did occur to us. The current setback, by the way, is 75 feet. The 100-foot shoreline setback that's shown in there is for the septic design to kind of give us a... It didn't really matter because the septic field ended up on the other side of the lot. But to give you a sense for how much square footage is there within the setbacks, the answer is 4,400 square feet of surface area. And I'm not an architect, but I did take a look at whether you could get a reasonable size house that were a reasonable, or I hate to get into the architectural aspect, a comparable architectural style house for that neighborhood, and it is feasible so that you don't have to build a flat iron building, in other words, to get a house square footage required by the deed on that lot within the setback requirements. It is feasible to get a reasonable shaped house, meeting the deed requirements within the 4,400 square feet.
Other questions?
Not for me right now.
Mr. Chairman? There are no rights at all over the upper road that goes along the northerly side of 9B?
No, sir, not with this lot. With, I might add, with some of the other lots there, they have double access written into the deed, written into their deeds. This access along with this one shown above here. Stop me if I'm wrong. The lots that have that double access are just 9C. What is it in 9B at all?
Well, 9B is part of the original conveyance to the Hamptons. You see it up in the upper left. And so it has access from the upper road. The only lot, as I understand the deed, that has double access is 9C.
My only comment is that I do have questions regarding the turnaround, and I would like to see that information in detail before I make any determination. I think I have a reputation as one of the board members who is concerned about rural character, and this certainly does have a unique character even for the town of Cape Elizabeth. However, if someone does have a deeded right-of-way and they have a otherwise legal lot, the impact of an individual lot within this area as to be developed as a single-family residence would be something that, at face value, I would not consider to be an extraordinary impact. That's all.
Other questions, comments? I have just a couple, and actually it's a question of our town planner. Under the current zoning and shoreline setback guidelines, what would be the setback of any structure improvement to the property from the shoreline itself, from the mean high, would it be mean high tide line?
Under our local ordinances right now, the shoreline zoning, it would be measured from the top of the bank, and it's a 75-foot setback. The drawing before you has a 100-foot shoreline setback. The building inspector and I did look at this lot to determine whether or not there were other factors that would make it unbuildable. And in looking at that, we also looked at the new shoreline zoning standards, and it appears that this lot would still be buildable under the guidelines that are proposed by the state for new shoreline zoning standards.
That would be my second question. What is the effect of the new shoreline zoning as far as just the front setback?
Well, the new shoreline zoning has a minimum frontage of 150 feet. This lot has, according to the applicant, a measurement which has been approved by DEP, a frontage of 152 feet, so they meet that standard. Secondly, a minimum lot size, and again, this is all relying on the guidelines that are recommended by the state. A local municipality can be more restrictive than the state guidelines, but assuming you adopt the same guidelines as the state's recommending, there's a minimum lot size of 30,000 square feet, and this lot here has in excess of 1 acre, so it also meets that standard. And again, if you move the setback from the top of the bank to 100 feet back, there still remains an area where a house could be built.
Is that what the setback would be under the new shoreline is 100
if feet? We adopted those standards.
The state standard,
yeah.
Currently, okay. Okay. I get my only concern, and I know part of this is not the purview of the planning board as it pertains to public access waiver, but the size of the building window drops down about 2,600 square feet, by my calculations anyway, with a 100-foot setback, and how that affects the character of the developable nature of that site. I'm not sure that that's even our purview, but certainly something I'm taking a look at. The rest of my questions deal with the feasibility of the turnaround and the acceptability of that turnaround to our town engineer. Is it possible? Have you obtained permission or legal right to cross? I think it's Lot 8. Presently, the right-of-way, or is the right-of-way that clear legally? Presently, it goes across Lot 9B, or at least that's how it shows. You're proposing to access the 15-foot width end of Lot 9A, crossing Lot 8 to get there.
The right-of-way, as it's described, is not very specific, you're right. It refers to an old road. But it talks about from that old road to the closest spot on Lot 9A, mm-hmm. With some other words about the road location can be changed as long as it allows the access to be still there to this lot. It's other than something to the effect that the closest location between where this road is and lot gets very nonspecific about exactly where the access off of that right-of-way is into the lot. I believe the intent was somewhere down here at the end. Whether it's right off the end or whether it's off this end, it's not very clear.
It's not clear, but when we had the site visit, there were some physical objects on another property that would cause a problem, in my opinion, anyway, if you approach from what would be the southerly side of Lot 9 of the subject site, anyway. There was a gateway, a brick gateway.
Right.
And there's a pretty narrow window to hit on that
right side.
I think probably the access was most appropriate from that end, and it's the closest point.
Remembering that lot, this lot 9A was really cut out of lot 8, 9B, and a lot, and this 9B as well. So this is all one owner, and it was not specific as to whether it was to come off of a lot now referred to as 9B or whether it was to come off of Lot A.
I understand the historical
and it probably wasn't the 9B
way.
At the time.
Right. Okay, I have no other questions other than the technical review of the turnaround, the emergency turnaround. I think that's a key issue. We didn't have it before us to review, and I think we await the town engineer's report as well. Any other
Mr.
questions?
Chair.
Yes.
There is no written document from the town engineer, but he has seen the document that the applicant has submitted for the turnaround. He believes that with a couple of passes, you could turn around a fire truck in that area. The fire chief has also looked at it and has no objections to being able to use that to turn around vehicles.
I guess I'd ask if the town planner could get a written statement from the fire chief, the police chief, but you're not anticipating, or we are anticipating a written response from the engineer?
We haven't requested one yet. I can get one.
I would like to see one.
Mr. Chairman, you mentioned that the with the 100-foot setback, that the square footage buildable lot size is 2,600 feet. Not to say that I'm infallible, but the number that I calculated was 3,150. It's just a...
Well, I was using the town planner's numbers there, so I... your apartment numbers are probably better.
Or ruler or what?
But it penciled in. And I got the wrong pair of glasses on tonight, so I probably didn't see them right anyway. It's small, regardless.
Yes. Smaller, right.
Yes. Other questions?
I guess I have maybe two comments. When we were out on the site, at least one other board member did comment on why there was the need to pave the first 50 feet, aside from that being one of many requirements in the ordinance, since we would be waiving several requirements if this is approved, and unless the town perhaps Public Works or somebody comes up with a compelling reason, or the abutters come up with a very compelling reason, I would certainly be in favor of waiving that, too. It's a perfectly charming road right now, and I can't see why one would pave it. And the other comment I would have would be, under our provisions for the public access waiver in the zoning ordinance, it indicates in the final paragraph of that section on my page 68 that in all cases, the board shall require recorded covenants binding the lots affected to assure that all conditions, construction, and maintenance requirements for said streets are binding upon the present and future owners of lots affected. And I wondered if it would be appropriate for some document to be submitted so that if we do find an acceptable hammerhead turn, that future owners could not then change the design. That's just the thought.
Any other comment? Questions?
I have one more. And it would be to the folks who live out there. We've received quite a lot of correspondence on this, and a lot of it really was under the misapprehension that a public access waiver was they were going to put a public road in. And I think we had visions of Crescent Beach North starting. And do you feel that that's clear now, that it isn't going to be a public road? I look at it, I'm not sure whether these people are so upset because they really think it's going to be a public road, or how they'd feel now, knowing perhaps more clearly what it is.
Not to interrupt, but the public hearing is closed, and I think...
I can ask.
I think we'll, unless the board would request it, I think we'll keep the public hearing closed. I would urge the public, if you have a comment, to certainly to write to the board, write to the town planner, and we'll have a chance to review your comments as it pertains to. I don't want to open up the public discussion again. Sorry.
That's fine. You're the boss.
Any other comments? Seeing none, do I hear a motion? Everybody need to get up and do some exercises to get this rolling?
I'll step up to the plate on this one. Is my microphone on? I submit the following findings of fact. Robert Middle, acting on behalf of Maine National Bank, trustee for the Sleeper Estate, is seeking a building permit for a lot paren map R2 lot 9A and paren located off Old Ocean House Road, which does not have frontage on an accepted town road. 2. In order to issue a building permit, a public access waiver is required under section 19-4-2B of the zoning ordinance. 3. The width of the private right-of-way does not meet the standards of section 16-3-2 of the subdivision ordinance or section 19-4-2B of the zoning ordinance. 4. Adequate emergency vehicle turnaround is not clearly depicted on the plans in accordance with section 19-4-2B of the zoning ordinance. 5. Technical information describing how vehicle site distance was measured is not included in the submission in accordance with section 19-4-2B of the zoning ordinance. 6. The public access waiver request substantially complies with the intent of section 19-4-2B of the zoning ordinance. Therefore, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted, the request of the Sleeper Estate for a public access waiver for a lot, map R2, lot 9A, located off Old Ocean House Road, is granted in accordance with section 19-4-2B of the zoning ordinance, subject to the following conditions. 1. That detailed plans depicting adequate access and turnaround area for emergency vehicles be submitted to the planning board, the town engineer, and the town planner for review and approval prior to the issuance of a building permit. And 2. that a description of the methodology used to determine site distance be submitted to the planning board, the town planner, and the town engineer prior to the issuance of a building permit. That's the end of the motion. I think there's also, I would second Judy Lardner's strong suggestion that the first 50 feet not be paved, but that's not a particular, I don't think that's technically before us with respect to this motion.
Where would you like to end your motion at number two, the end of number two? I think you need, if you want to include that, you need to make that a part of the motion.
The third condition would be that there be no necessity of paving the first 50 feet of the access roadway.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there any further discussion?
I simply have a question. In what capacity does the planning board have a review of the turnaround diagram if this is a conditional approval rather than a tabling?
I would refer to our town plan, but it sounds like there is none.
No, in my condition number one, it was that the planning board, in addition to the town engineer and the town planner, approved the turnaround design.
So that read the detailed plans depicting adequate access and turnaround area for emergency vehicles be submitted to the town
to the planning board, comma, the town engineer and the town planner
for review and approval. I can answer Tom's question, but I would add to that how that procedurally would take place without coming back to a town meeting. To a planning board meeting.
Well, the board has often made conditions that they've wanted additional information submitted to them to evaluate whether or not the condition has been met. If the applicant were to submit this information, it's simply added as an agenda item to the next meeting of the planning board. In addition, there would be comments available from the town engineer and the town planner as to the adequacy, but final determination of whether it was adequate would be the board's.
My question is, how does that differ from tabling? I guess it's the same question. How does that differ from a motion that would table this, the request, until we had a chance to review that?
My understanding of this would be that it would be a two-step approval process, that we would presumably approve if this vote passes. We would substantively approve the access waiver, but subject to conditions which would have to come back to the board later on. In the alternative, you could move to table, but if you did that, then all of the substance would be available for discussion at the next board meeting.
Correct. I guess I just ask if there are issues brought up by the town planner or the town engineer, public works, that would affect other items. Does that close that discussion on the other substantive issues to discussion at a following meeting?
I would think if in reviewing this something else came up, that would be precluded because it had already been approved. If there was something that was at all related to adequate emergency turnaround, anything that was related to that type of issue would be part of this condition and the board would be able to review.
Any other discussion?
I have one more.
Yes, Jennifer.
That motion says that he's applied for a building permit. Doesn't it?
He's seeking a building permit.
I'm just wondering if you're seeking a building permit, how can you have no plans for a particular property? Is that?
That's perhaps the town planner.
Well, the zoning ordinance specifically states that in applying for a building permit, that's what triggers the public access waiver request. The applicant has not submitted plans, has not filled out an actual building permit application, has not paid a building permit fee, but it would be pointless to do that for a lot that currently is unbuildable.
Okay.
I guess my only comment is just one board member. I came to this meeting with little more information than I had last month, other than going on the site walk, which raised a lot of questions. I have not had a chance to read the information that was submitted. It's just one board member. I would like the opportunity to have one more meeting to review all of the results. Any other discussion, questions? Seeing none, let's take a vote. All those in favor of the motion as read, please raise your right hand. Those opposed? It's a 3-2 negative vote. Do you need the names of those in for McKay, Parkhurst? Opposed? Etzel, Emery, King. I'd ask for another motion from the board at this time on the article.
Mr. Chairman, I'll make a motion for tabling. Shall I read the whole thing? It's essentially the same motion that was just made, except for it's a motion for tabling.
I'll ask the planner, do the findings of fact, should they be read in their entirety?
Well, typically, the board doesn't include findings of fact with tabling motions, only with motions for approval. There's nothing that says you can include them.
I'll just ask that you read the, the motion itself.
Be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted, the request of the Sleeper Estate for a public access waiver of lot map R2 lot 9A located off Old Ocean House Road is tabled to the regular July meeting of the Planning Board in accordance with section 19-4-2B of the zoning ordinance.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there any further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor of the motion as read, please raise your right hand. Those opposed? It's a unanimous vote. Table till next month. Thank you very much. The next order of business this evening is Stonegate Phase 4, 17-lot subdivision located in the area of Stonegate Road and proposed by Stonegate Associates. Preliminary subdivision plan review, section 16-2-4A. As I have in the past, due to a personal involvement in this application or this parcel of land, I'll ask to be recused from participating. I'll appoint Judith Kane as the acting chair.
This evening to discuss Stonegate Associates' proposal for a 17-lot subdivision adjacent to its existing Stonegate and Dyer Pond subdivisions off of Mitchell Road. little more than a year ago, we went on a site walk, the Planning Board, the Conservation Commission, and myself, to examine a proposed arrangement for a 22-lot subdivision in this same area. That plan was characterized by an entrance off of Greystone Road, where the current, where the entrance is proposed in the new plan, a central loop road in the middle of the site, and then two cul-de-sacs leading off the loop. That design was driven very strongly by the then existing subdivision ordinance, which required that dead-end streets not be more than 1,000 feet in length. Since that time, the town has considered its standards for dead-end streets as a whole and has revised that standard to allow dead-end streets 2,000 feet in length with appropriate planning board action. To respond to that change in the requirements, we have produced a new plan, which is essentially a 2,000-foot long street with a single cul-de-sac off of it. We have also reduced the number of lots to 17 so as to meet the requirement in the new ordinance that no more than 20 dwelling units be served by a dead-end street. The new design is quite frankly more pleasing, and I think that the changes to the ordinance that allowed longer dead-end streets were appropriate given the particular configuration of our site and many other similar pieces of land in Cape Elizabeth. I want to say that there have been several comments made by the town engineer and the town planner, and I am here this evening to present the facts in the case, to answer questions from members of the board, and I anticipate that based upon the questions and the feedback I get this evening, the prior comments by the town engineer and the town planner, that we will make appropriate revisions to the plan and be back before the board at their August meeting. We don't feel that we have quite enough time to make these revisions between now and the end of June in order to make the submittal deadline for the July meeting. So I would like, as much as the board is comfortable, for them to give us information as to what they see as the shortcomings of the plan, the things they like about the plan, so that we can, in our next proposal, attempt to incorporate as many of those comments as possible. The general scheme is to develop 16 lots off of a long dead-end street and a small cul-de-sac, and a 17th lot off of Stonegate Road that is an existing public road. We are also requesting some changes to lots number 49 and 51 of the prior approved Stonegate plan. These are relatively minor changes, but they need to come before the planning board since the original plan went through the planning board. The change on lot 49 consists of eliminating a 25-foot strip from lot 49 at its northern boundary to provide an access way into our proposed new lot 17. The change to lot 51 includes the widening of the toe of the road fill as we create our new road to serve the 16 lots, and to take a little corner of lot 51 for a drainage easement. The rest of the changes are really directly associated, or proposals are directly associated with our 16 new lots. These lots will be served by public water, septic systems, underground power, electric, and cable television. The lots range in size from an acre and a quarter to 6 acres and average about 1.9 acres. We are making our application under the cluster provisions of the ordinance, which allows one to evaluate the density of a site based on certain physical characteristics, multiply that by a factor, and come up with a maximum number of lots allowed. The maximum number of lots allowed on this site would be 23, but we are constrained by the 20-lot limit in the revised street ordinance. The interesting feature, I think, of this project is that there is approximately 45 acres of land that will not be utilized for house lots of roads that will be added to the existing 40-acre Stonegate conservation land. Much of this land is what they call shrub and wooded swamp. Some of this land is some rather gorgeous upland. The edges of the lots are generally confined to the upland portion of the site. There is access to the proposed public area at 1, 2, 3, 4 points from this subdivision. Along a boundary with the Stonegate conservation land of 1,500 feet or so, and from the Dyer Pond subdivision that comes in off of Shore Road. In laying out this subdivision, this is really the third step in a development of this whole 245-acre parcel. We think we've been responsive to maintaining circulation through this site. The site has traditionally been used as recreational area. There are cross-country ski trails out there. There are walking paths out there. It has seen a lot of use by the general public. We have maintained circulation paths both north to south and west to east across this. This whole project represents a link in the proposed greenbelt to connect Fort Williams to Crescent Beach State Park. The submittal that you have before you, consisting of plans and an orange booklet, does not contain every last bit of information about the project. We made previous submittals about that much at the time of the original application. What I attempted to do in formulating the orange book was to hit highlights and summary points. If there's a member of the board that requires further information, we certainly have it available and can make it available for the board. One of the key benefits of this new plan over the old plan is that we are reducing the number of wetlands crossings and our wetlands impacts generally. In the case of this particular project, we are seeking the wetlands, the permission to do work in the wetlands under the old form of the ordinance, which calls it the Resource Protection District. Under the new form of the ordinance, it's either a critical wetland or a wetland. The kinds of impacts that we are proposing is in the area where the new access road enters the site, we are crossing a short stretch of wetland. This is our major wetlands impact. We are filling a width of approximately 70 feet to a maximum depth of 6.5 feet and almost 700 cubic yards of fill. This impact is virtually identical for this proposal and the prior proposal. We also will be impacting wetlands in the vicinity of Station 10+00 of our new proposed road. We have taken the road and purposefully, there's a very narrow band of upland separated by a wetland to this side and a wetland to that side. And we have taken and routed the road to make maximum use of that narrow band of upland. However, in order to maintain adequate depth of cover for utilities and drainage, we have had to make the base of the fill just a little bit wider than the wetland area. We are impacting to a maximum depth of 5.4 feet and a total of 135 cubic yards of fill in the wetland. Those statistics are discussed in the narrative, which is a part of the Orange Book, on page 3 of that narrative. In the prior plan, we had these impacts also at this point here, where we had proposed crossing back over a long arm of upland to make this loop. There are still two other possibilities for arrangement of this project. One would be to cross the wetlands somewhere in this vicinity and come back out to Stonegate Road, where we have proposed access for our new lot 17. That obviously would be one more wetlands crossing. The other would be to drive a road through to the extension of the road serving our Dyer Pond project. That also would require another wetlands crossing and would require the construction of approximately 1,800 lineal feet of road, not serving any additional lots. We have therefore come to this arrangement. Oh, there's one other area of reduced wetlands impact. We had proposed a utility crossing in this area here originally. That utility crossing has been eliminated, and the utility function now takes place within the roadway. We thought that while that is a little more expensive approach, it represents one that is consistent with the idea of no impact where there need not be impact. This is a substantial project, and I think the board would agree with that. I could stand here all night probably and talk about the nitty-gritty of it, but I think I would rather get to questions and comments from the board, if that's okay with you.
Thank you for your review. In view of the fact that many of us were not even here when the first plan came before us, it's completely new to them. I've been involved with it all along. I do like your new plan. It's very nice. I have some questions and comments, but I will open it to the board if they have anything to say. I do think I may well be the only one who is, no, were you here?
I was here for the sidewalk a year ago.
Yeah. Okay.
And Mrs. McKay was here also for the workshop and the sidewalk.
But following up on that, Mr. Taylor, I guess I wonder how difficult it would be for you to put together a full package, not necessarily for me, but for, you've got at least two people on the board, literally, who have not seen this before.
That's fine. It's just that the materials that you've got now cost $450 to print. And because we're required to print 23 copies of everything between all the department heads and consultants and the board members and the Conservation Commission members who are all involved in this process. It's a matter of dollars and cents, and I'm just trying to conserve those at these difficult economic times. I could perhaps put together, say, two complete packages or three complete packages, whatever number the board felt was appropriate as sort of reference sets, rather than trying to provide 23 complete sets of everything again, if that was acceptable.
I think that would be acceptable to me. Now, I know the town engineer had a very serious request that things be put together in one place so that there would be a reference point, and the town planner may have something to say about that.
I guess I just wanted to come in and say that the applicant and I and the planning board chair have discussed this, and for certain pieces of information, the applicant has submitted copies for me, for the town files, and for the town engineer, and we've agreed that if any of the planning board members would also like copies of those items, that they would be supplied. But in order to reduce paper that might not otherwise be reviewed, in addition, because of the significant changes in the plan, the applicant had discussed with me the desire to collect comments from the board and then make a thorough revision of the most recent plan, which the board would receive. And I would assume that with that new submission, it would be, again, a complete submission, which I would hope would address the concerns of the town engineer.
Well, a complete submission, for instance, requires a copy of the HHE Form 200 for every lot for all 23 people. And it requires many things that I don't think all people are going to look at. If the board really believes it's necessary, we will, of course, provide it. But I would just ask that you consider whether or not it's necessary.
Through the chair. I guess, unless there's some objection from the board, I think we've established a procedure whereby certain information is submitted to the engineer and to the town planner. The HHE 200 forms is one example of something in the past that has been submitted to the planner, and if there's interest in the board, additional copies will be provided. I think another example was the drainage study. A third example is the recent road section plans that you submitted to myself and to the town engineer. Additional copies were not provided to the board, although if any board member would like a copy, they would be provided.
I think that procedure is certainly acceptable. I guess I wanted to know, though, are you intending to take the comments that you received tonight and the comments of the town engineer that you've received in writing and submit to us a revised partial package which attempts to answer the questions raised tonight and the questions of the town engineer?
Yes.
Thank you.
Do we have any other comments from the board?
I like the plan.
Judy? I think, at least for the members who haven't been involved up to now, and because of the difference in the road alignment, it would be helpful to have a site walk.
That brought up too another thing, which was that do we need also to have another public hearing?
Well,
my own personal feeling is that, as I remember the last one, the objections were minimal, if almost at all, if there was one. Has it substantially changed enough? I do think another site walk would be tremendously helpful.
If I may, with regard to public hearing issues, included as narrative item 12 in the orange book are the minutes for the public hearing. So the board can review those and see if there are substantive issues that do require another public hearing. It is our opinion that we have responded to all the issues raised there and that it would not be required, but that determination is, of course, the board's. With regard to a site walk, I've been in contact with the Conservation Commission chair, and we had discussed tentatively having a site walk with the Conservation Commission at 6 p.m. on July the 11th, at which point we would go on and meet with the Conservation Commission about the aspects of the plan in which they're involved.
That's a Thursday evening?
That's a Thursday evening. And I suggest that it might be appropriate for this board to consider making that a mutual sidewalk and a mutual meeting, or alternatively, almost any weekend through the summer, with the exception of the July 4th weekend and the July 20th weekend, I am available for site.
Do you have any feeling from the board on that?
I think the Thursday meeting makes sense to have the Conservation Commission with us.
I think so, too. Mm-hmm. We've got more input, and Thursday evening is nice. Why don't we all plan then to put that on the agenda? 6 p.m. and meeting at...
Why don't we meet at Stone Gate?
At the road.
Stone Gate Road, at its intersection with Greystone Road, mm-hmm. and there's a sewage pumping station mm-hmm. directly across the street.
Okay.
At 6 p.m.
Do we have some other comments?
Just a minimal comment. Aside from hoping that you'll look at the engineer's comments and address those before we see plans again, I would definitely like to see building envelopes clearly on these plans. Much as we had with the Highlands, I thought that was very helpful mm-hmm. to know exactly where buildings would and wouldn't go.
We will furnish building envelopes.
Thank you.
What are we doing here? Couple of the comments I wanted to add were also to mention the building envelopes, which Ms. Lardner has. The engineer's report, I presume you're going to go through with a fine-tooth comb and address many of those issues. Those are small technical issues, a lot of them, and I don't see that there should be any problem with a resolution.
I don't believe there will be any problem either. One of the issues brought up in Mr. Morin's letter was an issue that we had previously discussed with Mr. Hunter and have correspondence in the file that contradicts this particular review. So our approach is going to be we just need to sit down and spend an hour or two mm-hmm. go through it so that we all understand what is necessary and then make mm-hmm. the appropriate revisions.
One of the final things that I'd wanted to bring up at tonight's meeting, if not for necessarily for the board's sake, but certainly for the people who haven't seen this in a year or so, was a very interesting pedestrian access walkways that you had planned. I remember distinctly the, I want to say Wagoners?
The Gatchells, perhaps?
Gatchells, that was close, right? and they were, proposing some kind of an easement across their lot even to tie into this. And I'd like to, if you could explain how that was going to work and then what your plans were for the street, the continuation of Dyer Pond Road, such as it is.
Maybe I can speak loud enough so you can hear me without the benefit of the microphone. There is an existing local pattern of use where people from the Cranbrook subdivision and the Mitchell Road area cross the Gatchells lot, which is in this vicinity, on an existing footpath. And while the Gatchells have not volunteered to have an easement across their property, they have said that they would find it appropriate for there to be an easement on this property, our property, that would meet with that footpath. That easement is in this location where my finger is moving up and down, and we have provided a 25-foot wide pedestrian easement right there. We have also provided an easement from the end of the existing Woods Road, which is sometimes called the Allen Road, that connects with Mitchell Road and comes to this corner of the site that ties into our proposed new street. There is a 50-foot wide road, which we are calling Dyer Pond Extension, which connects to the end of another 50-foot wide right-of-way running to the end of the paving in our Dyer Pond project. We are proposing that 50-foot wide strip be granted to the town in the event that future growth in the town or changes in traffic patterns make it suitable for there to be a through connection from Shore Road to Mitchell Road through the Dyer Pond and Stonegate projects. We are proposing that there be no improvement of that at this time. Other points of access that exist there is a 50-foot wide right-of-way tying into Dyer Pond Road extension from the Robinson property to the south. It runs just to the Robinson property line. It was placed there at the request of the planning board during the approval process for the Dyer Pond project, so that if there was a development of the Robinson parcel, there was potentially another access out of the Robinson parcel. There is an existing network of footpaths that crisscross the site. The principal footpaths go from the Allen Road across the site, dipping onto the Robinson land and dipping back into the vicinity of our 50-foot wide right-of-way. And we have preserved that travel path by our pedestrian easement that meets the Allen Road and goes out to the proposed Greystone Road over to hook into this easement that I have mentioned that meets the Gatchell's land. And then that easement from the Gatchell land across the project dumps out into this area of common open space, and one can walk without getting their feet wet in an easterly and southerly direction, or in an easterly and or continue easterly and then turn north around the end of these lots here. There's an upland peninsula up here which is connected to the Dyer Pond project. At the time of the approval of the Dyer Pond project, we gave the town a conservation easement across that parcel of land. We retain, at this time, ownership of that parcel of land. However, it is our plan that that parcel of land also be included in the grant of conservation land to the town that is described as a part of this proposal. There are paths proposed, not existing, for connection of this neck of land with the upland open space area that is a part of Dyer Pond, and with the upland open space area that is a part of Stonegate subdivision. When all this property comes into the hands of the town can do what they wish to do to develop those areas. We also have connections through our Dyer Pond project out to Shore Road, and turning north before you get to Shore Road and connecting up to the conservation land of Stonegate also. The conservation land of Stonegate connects right across the street, terminates right across the street from the Fort Williams Park. You can, from Fort Williams, travel over the proposed open space and conservation land practically all the way to Mitchell Road. There are easements in the area of the Canterbury condominium project that gets you down towards the hockey field. There are easements in the hockey rink area that get you down towards the school, and those are links in the proposed greenbelt. It is not yet continuous from Fort Williams to Crescent Beach State. I think that really addresses the local circulation issues and the greenbelt issues. Are there any further questions?
I have two. This is a pet thing of mine, is this pedestrian access, and you really are in a position to have just, and you have been very good about it. My question was, number one, you just said that it would be almost possible to go from Fort Williams to Mitchell Road. Where would you not be able to? Or why?
At some point, you've got to get on the pavement of Stonegate Road to get out there. To be on conservation land.
Oh, I see.
Land.
All right, vis-a-vis. But versus if I took, you know, and went for a walk, I would...
If you wish to go for a walk...
I could use between
you
roads.
You can go from Mitchell Road to Fort Williams, but part of the way you have to walk on bituminous pavement.
Okay, well, I'll live with that for now. Number two is the... Could you explain in more detail the rights and the usage of the Dyer Pond Road extension? Will there be pedestrian rights to use that?
Yes.
Will it be cleared, or how are you marking it?
We anticipate or our proposal is, that it would be available for use on the same terms as the extension that falls within the Dyer Pond project proper, which is essentially a 50-foot wide strip of land through the woods as we give it to the town. If the town wishes to improve it, it may improve it. We are providing monumentation along the way so that it is locatable in the woods, but it is not our intent to construct any footpaths or the like.
Okay, and how are you going to monument it? I got lost out there that day. That's why I'm
the way it is monumented now is with the iron property pins and with flagging.
Flagging?
Flagging is not permanent. And I would suggest that in the past, when we've had discussions with the Conservation Commission, they've essentially said to us, we kind of like to get it in a rustic state and keep it that way. And I would suspect that perhaps they'd go out there and put some paint blazes on trees or something like that that would make it easily identifiable. Right now, if there's a piece of flagging missing and you get confused easily in the woods, I could see how you could end up doing something like that.
Mm-hmm. Very good. Do we have any other questions? Mr. Eichenberg?
Did you depict for me where the 25-foot setbacks are from the wetland and where the 100-foot setbacks are?
Looking on your full-scale plan, because they're a little, they may be a little faint in the reduced-size plan that you're looking at, you can see a line that is a bunch of periods.
Edge of wetland, 25 feet.
This far, so everybody else can see that. The thin, solid line is the edge of the wetland as identified by our biologists and as located by our surveyors in the field. The dotted line that looks like just a series of periods is the 25-foot setback line from that. The line that consists of a solid line, three dashes, a solid line, three dashes, is the 100-foot setback from the edge of the wetland.
Where the buildings will be, where you anticipate structures may be within 25 feet of
whatever? I'm not prepared to stand up and point them out in detail right now. What I would suggest is that we will show those on a building envelope basis for the next submittal. What I will say is that I anticipate that on certain lots, Lot 1, Lot 13, we will have houses within buffer. On Lot 3, the driveway location will be within 100 feet of the wetland. Lot 4 and 5, I anticipate house construction within 100 feet of the wetland. Our initial proposal to both this body and the Maine Department of Environmental Protection was that construction in that strip of land between the 25-foot setback and the 100-foot setback be performed in accordance with something called the permit by rule regulations of the DEP. And what those are is a set of construction standards as to how one must work in close proximity to the wetland in order to minimize or eliminate adverse impact. The DEP has said to us also that they prefer the building envelope approach to that more general approach of using the permit by rule standard. So we anticipate developing building envelopes for all lots, as I mentioned earlier. I'm just not prepared enough to tell you where they are this evening.
Are we all set? We need a motion to table, and I believe we agreed that it will be to the August meeting. We're all in agreement with that. Could I have someone make a motion? And there's not one written down, so you have to create it yourselves.
Motion to table.
started that motion.
I'll even turn my microphone on. My motion is, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted, the request of Stonegate Associates for preliminary subdivision plan approval is tabled to the regular August meeting of the Planning Board in accordance with Section 19-4-2B of the zoning ordinance. Do I hear a second?
Second. May I?
Yes.
Just a point of order here. We also have pending applications for wetland alteration, road construction, and resource protection district, an amendment to an already approved plan, and it is our understanding that those are also being tabled to the August meeting.
Yes. Do we need to amend the motion? Or
I believe that was included.
Included in the whole thing. All right. Yes. Everything is moved to table till August. Is seconded? All those in favor? Opposed? None.
Thank you very much, and I look forward to seeing you all on the 11th.
We'll be there.
That's fine.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes, Mr. Emery.
In anticipation of the next project before the board, I must excuse myself. I'm a member of the firm that's making the presentation.
I noticed your name involved there.
Thank you.
Certainly excused. And you're right. As soon as I find my agenda, we'll get to that item. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
And due to a personal bias of extremely strong personal opposition to certain aspects of this project, I wish to be removed from this.
Okay, well, certainly.
Thank you.
That requires that I will appoint both of our associates as voting members, both Tim and Judy, to join us as voting members on this article. Any others? Next article is the community center request by the town of Cape Elizabeth for conversion of a single-family home to community center in the vicinity of 1226 Struer Road, site plan review, section 19-2-9. This time I'd ask the applicant or a representative thereof to briefly summarize the project that you've brought before us. Good evening.
Thank you. Good evening, Chairman Hetzel, members of the Planning Board. My name is George Terrian. I'm Terrian Architects, and I'm here on behalf of the developer, the town of Cape Elizabeth, who is here in person as manager Michael McGovern, to whom I'm sure we will be turning to answers for questions as they may come up. Also with me is the architect for the project, Bob Howe, principal of Terrian Architects, and Michael DeLuca, civil engineer for the project. I'm going to make a very brief introduction, ask Bob Howe to take you through the specifics. It's my understanding that we are here this evening to present to you our submission for your determination of the completeness of the application. We are in receipt with a copy of the memorandum prepared by planner Maureen O'Mara, dated 18 June 1991, and we will fully comply with the recommendations in that for additional information when we return 1 month from now for your review. We are also meeting with the Zoning Board of Appeals next Tuesday, and when we return to you in a month, we will be asking you for specifically a waiver of the 10-foot setback from the property line for the drive, which it will be, where the drive is located, within the 20-foot right-of-way that runs with the property. We will be asking also for you to allow our preliminary stormwater analysis to stand in that we believe that it has, the stormwater has a minimal effect, certainly less than 5% increase in the rate of flow off of the site, which of course is at the top of the watershed at the top of the hill. And we are also requesting, will also be requesting, that the Planning Board not impose additional traffic analysis on the applicant, because we believe that the impact from traffic will be minimal. Just one more highlight before I ask Bob Howe to go through the specifics. The septic system that presently exists is not documented in the records of the town, but it works quite adequately for the existing use. We will not be increasing flows as designed for the change in use, and so therefore do not propose to rebuild the septic system until the day that it someday may fail, at which point the town would propose to connect it to the town sewer. We will also be asking for a town permission for the sign permit when the time comes. And with that introduction, let me turn the presentation over to Bob Howe, who will take you through the specifics of the proposal.
Thank you. Please interrupt me anytime during the presentation if I leave you or you need a question answered. Basically, I want to cover two items: the building itself, what's happening to the internals, workings of the building, the immediate site plan around the building, and how. And then later on, in discussion, we'll follow through the plan, and we'll see how it affects the total site, including the expansion of the parking area in back of the town hall here. The town is interested in converting the present residence to a community service facility. In that endeavor, they are planning to provide for handicap access, handicap parking, a walkway, a drive to the building, parking for the facility, conversion of the a bathroom inside for handicap accessibility, improvements to the lighting, and some minor restructuring to open up some of the smaller bedrooms so that there is more common space. The building, 126 Shore Road, I'm going to start right at the north end of the site, along Shore Road. The driveway entrance is now somewhat to the right of the existing drive, as you look at it, that is to the west, driving south. We have provided two parking areas for handicapped vehicle, handicapped individuals, in approximately the same area where the driveway area is now. We'll be abandoning the present driveway access, and there will be two not new parking areas there. But the drive access then would parallel the west side of the building and would, on the and on its west side, would align with that grove of trees and the present fence, so that we are less than the required setback from the property line, but it is within the right-of-way here, which is 20 feet on the further to the west of that property line or the driveway. Following south then, we approach the drop-off area on the west side of the building, which will serve into a new gathering area inside. The idea is to invert the garage so that we put a handicap ramp inside the garage. The intent here is to maintain the residential character of the building without changing its appearance, therefore, on the outside, its present entrance, and its appearance from the street. Further south, then, there is a sidewalk adjacent to the building, and we are maintain a parallel path to the fence on the west. Eventually pass towards through the backyard. There's a picket fence that separates the sidewalk and drive access from the yard in the back of the building to the south of the building. The road proceeds, then the drive proceeds to the south, still parallel to the property line, and a driveway access turns to the left to a parking area for 20 vehicles. That is approximately 180 to 200 feet into the site. From that, approximately that point also, and that's more or less aligned to the present end of the, this line here is the present fence on the south side of that yard. There is a, planned a stockade fence that would sit on the property line continuing south to the intersection of the present fence that separates the town lot from the proposed site improvements here. Again, further south on that drive, there is a sidewalk that's continuing that will connect into the expansion of the parking lot to the east of this building. That sidewalk is meanders through a grove of trees, missing as many trees as possible, and is will serve as a walkway access from this expanded parking lot in back of the town hall. The expansion for the parking lot requires improvements to the pavement. Well, will require full depth of new pavement to expand this lot to the east. It will then provide parking for 68 cars back here. The drive pattern through the town hall, around the town hall building itself, will remain the same. It's a one-way loop in and out. Drive, the driveway between this, the west end of the parking lot now for the town hall and Shore Road is also a two-way lane, 20 feet wide. There will be improvements to the site, the present site of the town hall parking. There'll be new painted lines to give some order to some of the parking area, some plantings and two islands that will be part of the improvements, and some reorganization and repainting of lines around the present garage here to separate driveway and parking from the front, from those garage doors. George mentioned the septic improvements that, or the septic work of the present building. It is calculation, we are actually diminishing the amount of flow rate. The we anticipate use for 50 people in the building. For a business use, that requires something like 250 gallons per day. Where a three-bedroom single residence would require a capacity of up to 336 gallons per day. So there is no change. It's actually a diminished flow. There is some site. There is some fence work around here to the east of that parking, new parking area, with some. A buffer of hemlock trees, new plantings around the entrance drive, sign is located along the street here on Shore Road. There is some lighting down through here. They consist of 150 watt high pressure sodium lamps and a flood lamp, a floodlight that is down in this location in the new parking area, a 400 watt high-pressure sodium lamp. I think that would conclude the general review of the site. Any specific concerns about further town's use? I would ask Mike perhaps to answer those questions. But I'd open it to the board at this point. Thank you.
Thank you very much. What we have before us is a completeness issue initially. I think just try to there are a lot of questions and so forth, but I'd like to focus as much as we could on the completeness issues first. I'll open it up to the board for questions, both of the town planner and the applicant. Any questions? I would ask our planner just to quickly go down through the list, highlight any of the issues that appear to you.
Starting with, the, unless there are questions at previous items, starting with item 5C, the location of easements. Typically, the board receives copies of the actual deed language. The applicant has now submitted that to me, and I have that in my file, so if anyone wants to see that, let me know. Skipping down to number 6D, proposed parking areas, there is some additional information that the town engineer has requested, which led me to indicate that that was a partially complete issue. In particular, he asked for additional detail for the area south of Town Hall, over on this right side, and what was being done there. It's an existing parking area now, and there is some discussion about some changes and some improvements, and he wanted some additional information of that area in particular. Most of the information that the town engineer listed treated as technical issues that would be part of a plan revision rather than information that was incomplete. So only those things that I felt indicated a lack of information have I reflected in this list before you. Under item 10, parking, loading, and unloading area locations, the town engineer and I am recommending that there be additional information submitted on traffic analysis. There is no information submitted at this time. Under item 12A, location design of existing proposed stormwater systems, there has been no information submitted by the applicant on the existing septic system design. The applicant has discussed, however, that the existing system is functioning appropriately, that there doesn't appear to be an additional capacity problem with the changed use. In addition, the building inspector has stated that any project of this sort would be required to show that there would be an appropriate backup system. In this case, the applicant has the possibility of hooking up into the sewer system, and there is reserve capacity for municipal uses, so that certainly is a backup to be able to hook up to the sewer if this system does fail. Any questions on that?
How much reserve capacity is there for municipal use in the sewer system?
I guess I would refer that to the town manager.
I didn't bring that material with me, but back when the Southern Cape Elizabeth facility planning process was completed, an allowance was made essentially doubling the current municipal use that was then in effect, and up to this point none of that has been used.
And there's no other project online that is currently contemplated?
The only one is the Public Works garage, and that particular project is not anticipated to increase flow because it's a continuation of the same use in just a different amount of space.
Thank you.
Unless there are other questions, continuing on with item 12B, the location design of sink. Well, actually, we did that. Let's go back to 12A, stormwater systems. There was an issue raised by the town engineer that there was an assessment made of increased stormwater flows, which appears to be approximately 5%. Those flows eventually entered the Atlantic Ocean, so there's no question that there's adequate capacity at the outfall point. The question is whether what kind of impacts will be experienced between the property, the community center property, and that outflow at the ocean, and how much 5% will impact that intermediate area. The town engineer has requested additional information be submitted, and the applicant is I guess requesting that no additional information is needed. I guess going down to 12C, location design of potable water supply. Typically, the board receives a letter from the Portland Water District stating whether or not there is adequate capacity to serve the project. The